We hope the country will also take something from this. That Joe's death will have meaning. That those in politics, the media, and our own communities who seek to divide us will face an unassailable wall of British tolerance.
Good evening from Birstall. On the 16th of June, this small town in Yorkshire witnessed the brutal murder outside the library just behind me of a young member of parliament who left behind a family and a catalogue of unfinished work that marked her out as a rising political star. Today at the Old Bailey, Thomas Mayer was found guilty of her murder and sentenced to spend the rest of his life in prison. In passing sentence, Mr. Justice Wilkie praised Joe Cox, who worked to better the lot of those less fortunate than her. He admonished the killer for using murder to advance a white supremacist and Nazi cause. That makes this a tragic and shocking first in British political history, at a time when the country stood at a perhaps unprecedented crossroads. Her murder was a brutal political act from a killer who refused to explain why.
Jill Cox's family want to know why she's dead. You've committed an act in a very public place, in a very public manner. What is that message? Why have you done this?
Also tonight, Chancellor Hammond's first autumn statement effectively says goodbye to paying off Britain's massive deficit and instead commits the government to borrowing a lot. Philip Hammond puts the price of Brexit at £62 billion over 5 years, and a lot more if it's a hard Brexit. On top of that, £23 billion borrowed pounds to spend on houses, roads, rail and broadband.
We have chosen, Mr. Speaker, to borrow to kickstart a transformation in infrastructure and innovation investment.
Plus, as a man is found guilty of drugging and murdering four young gay men in East London, 17 police officers are under investigation for failing to stop him in his tracks. And the Secretary General of NATO meets the Prime Minister to discuss the new global order. Trump in power, Russia resurgent, and a world in conflict. We've been talking to him.
The police said it amounted to an act of terrorism. Thomas Mayer, the neo-Nazi who shot and stabbed the MP Joe Cox here in the West Yorkshire constituency exactly 1 week before the EU referendum, was jailed for life at the Old Bailey today for her murder. Ordering that Mayer should spend the rest of his natural life behind bars, the judge, Mr. Justice Wilkie, condemned the killer in the strongest terms, both for his actions and his refusal to enter a plea. This meant that Mrs. Cox's family and friends had to relive her last moments over and over again in court over the last 10 days. I spent the day here in Birstall finding out more from those who loved and admired the MP. But first, our Home Affairs correspondent Darshna Soni reports from the Old Bailey on the trial and what we know about what motivated the killer.
A loner who was lonely. A 53-year-old man who had never had a visitor in 13 years. Thomas Mayer, known as Tommy to his neighbours.
He were a nice neighbour. He were always really pleasant if he saw you. Always said morning, afternoon, evening.
A recluse who hid his extreme far-right views. Who, the night before his crime, went to see a spiritual healer.
He was in this room asking for some information about different holistic therapies that we offer here, in particular meditation and relaxation, reflexology.
The man who had sought relaxation techniques went on to savagely murder his MP in broad daylight as she went about her constituency business.
For the person who did this, we have nothing but pity that his life was so devoid of love and consumed with hatred that this became his desperate and cowardly attempt to find meaning. The killing of Joe was a political act, an act of terrorism.
Thomas Mayer stared straight ahead, completely impassive as the verdicts were read out. He had not offered a defence, had not said a word during hours of police interviews. It was as if he had wanted his crime to speak for itself. And yet, at the very end of the trial, he did ask if he could make a statement today, but the judge refused. The judge said that Mayer had murdered Joe Cox to advance a political cause of violent white supremacism. And yet, he was never charged under terrorism legislation. This is his police interview, in which he refused to account for his actions.
You committed an act in a very public place, in a very public manner. Which says to us that you want people to know that you've done it.
Mayor disagreed with all that his MPs stood for. Jo Cox was a rising political star who had campaigned passionately on the plight of Syrian refugees. Her belief in putting others first would be demonstrated even as she lay dying.
Whilst we celebrate our diversity, the thing that surprises me time and time again as I travel around the constituency is that we are far more united and have far more in common than that which divides us.
Mrs. Cox also advocated Remain, and in the heat of the summer's referendum campaign, Thomas Mayer had started collecting cuttings on her speeches.
Did he ever talk to you about foreigners or not liking outsiders?
He never spoke about anything. Not anything.
Katie Green lived next door to Thomas Mayer for 13 years. She knew him as the perfect neighbour. A few weeks before the murder, he had helped her do her garden, and he always helped the elderly with their shopping. But he never invited anybody into his home.
Even at Christmases, you know, possibly his birthday, we've never seen a visitor in 13 years apart from postman. So, but at first it was quite odd, but he just got used to him, just being on his own nearly.
His neighbours never realised he had family. In fact, his mother lived nearby. But she had remarried a black man and Mayer disapproved, choosing not to live with them. Mayer was unemployed and had been treated for anxiety. He volunteered as a gardener at this country park. In an interview with the local paper 5 years ago, he said, "Many people who suffer from mental illness are socially isolated." He never hid his mental health issues, but what he did hide was his political views. Inside his neatly kept house, clues to his personality were found in his precisely ordered cupboards. Detectives found a bookshelf brimming with texts on white supremacy and a huge collection of Nazi material adorned with swastikas, including this golden eagle ornament. Methodically filed, he also kept press cuttings on Jo Cox and on the right-wing Norwegian mass killer Anders Breivik. They also found an SS officer's book on race theory and mate selection. Tellingly, Mayer had researched sons who kill their mother for miscegenation or marrying outside their race. In the 1990s, Mayer had flirted with a number of extremist far-right groups, but detectives believe he didn't have the social skills to become an active member. The first time he appeared in court, charged with Jo Cox's murder, he quoted these propaganda lyrics as his name, stating it as "Death to traitors, freedom for Britain." Those who have investigated this case have tried to understand what motivated Thomas Mayer, and there's a particularly puzzling aspect to his story. It was over 20 years ago when he dabbled with joining a number of right-wing extremist groups, but he doesn't seem to have been very active, and his membership doesn't seem to have lasted very long. In the years that followed, he quietly got on with his life here, living alone, being a good neighbour to all of those around him. So what suddenly, after all this time, prompted him to decide to go out and kill an MP?
Well, Thomas Mayer seems like another potentially isolated individual drawn to extreme right ideology, and in particular the elements of racism and white supremacism that one can find there. And again, one can find it in many different forums. So in the 1990s, people on the extreme right might have been talking about, let's say, apartheid, and much more recently they were talking about Brexit.
Researchers say the toxic atmosphere of the Brexit campaign gave right-wing groups who had gone quiet since the fall of the BNP and others a new rallying cause. The government's prevent strategy has been accused of failing to respond. In some parts of the country, prevent referrals linked to neo-Nazism are overtaking Islamic extremism.
This offence of murder was a politically and ideologically motivated attack.
So shouldn't he have been charged under terrorism legislation?
No, not necessarily.
It's just that a lot of people won't understand why a white supremacist hasn't been charged under terrorism legislation.
A murder that's committed in West Yorkshire would go to either a Leeds or Bradford Crown Courts. So the fact that it came here meant that it was a designated terrorist case. But he's not been charged with any specific terrorist offences because, as we've heard today, he's got a whole life tariff. So what would that add to it?
Instead, Thomas Mayer was charged with murder. He was filmed in this library, finding out what day and time Jo Cox was due to hold her constituency surgery. The night before, he walked into this alternative therapy centre and said he was looking for spiritual healing.
He'd said that he'd been on medication for quite some time. He'd found benefits from holistic therapies in the past.
In your mind, how do you reconcile the fact that he was here asking for help and yet the next day he went out and did this dreadful thing?
I think it was reaching out and asking for help for himself, whether that was getting him in a state of mind to be able to carry out the act or calm himself or asking for help. I'll never know those answers.
Mayer arranged to go back to the centre the next day, but he never showed up. Instead, he got up that morning and walked into Birstall. He hung around the library waiting, eating a chocolate bar. When Jo Cox turned up in her car, he struck, shouting, "Britain first," as he attacked. The UK's counter-terrorism police insist they are tackling the threat from the far right. Thomas Mayer was given a whole life tariff, with the judge telling him that the true patriot was Jo Cox.
Darshan Soni reporting. Well, the trial of Jo Cox's killer may have ended, but for the people in this constituency, the healing has a long way to go. The Labour MP was much loved here, but her murder came when Britain was on the cusp of monumental change. Now, the values that she held so dear, freedom, inclusiveness, openness, appear to be challenged by a changing mood at home and abroad.
The ghost of the Industrial Revolution still clings to this town like early winter mist. Joseph Priestley, the man who discovered oxygen, became Birstall's most famous son. At a time when places like this with their textile mills made the Industrial Revolution that made the empire. Now she has become Birstall's most famous, the local hero turned star politician, a force of nature felled by a force of evil. Brutally killed in broad daylight in front of the library where her murderer spent so much time nosing through neo-Nazi material. Birstall is trying to get ready for Christmas, but according to the local vicar, this town still feels like an open wound.
I think people have wanted to move on, but that incident has really made its mark on the community of Birstall. We don't want to be remembered as the place where Jo was killed, but we do want to remember her and all that she gave to this community.
Back in the summer, a few days after her death, the leaders from Westminster descended on Birstall to feel the nation's pain and create a moment of sober reflection in the feverish final days before the Brexit vote.
So where we see hatred, where we find division, where we see intolerance, we must drive it out of our politics and out of our public life and out of our communities.
But a week later, he was driven out of a job, and Britain and the world has entered a new political era, something which today deeply troubles Jo's widower.
I think in the UK, there was a real a moment of reflection after Jo's death. And I think the important thing is that we keep reflecting on where our politics is. You know, British politics is not where American politics is or where French politics is. But there is still a minority of people at the extremes of politics who try to focus the national debate on minority communities, who try to blame groups for complex problems, who try to pretend that the reason that people don't have jobs is not because of the economy, but it's because of migrants. And that is a deeply worrying trend.
Last month, during the by-election to fill Jo's seat, the mainstream parties stayed away out of respect, and Labour easily held on.
Would it surprise you to know that those are British National Party policies?
However, four extreme right-wing groups fielded candidates. They all lost their deposits, but the fact that they even came showed a newfound confidence.
Can I give you that back, please?
Yeah. Because do you have any particular objection to what we're proposing here?
Well, I don't believe that you should be putting up anyway, because Conservatives aren't,
yeah.
Liberals aren't, UKIP aren't,
yeah.
And I don't think you should do. Out of respect for Jo Cox.
Sure, but what about
and I wasn't a Labour supporter, and I'm not.
No.
But I just think that.
Today in Jo's pub, no relation, The men mourned Jo Cox, but hailed the politics that she abhorred, both here and there.
I think Donald Trump is going to be absolutely fantastic for the world, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. He's a businessman, and it's like a businessman knows business. Politicians don't know business. Mm-hmm. Look at the NHS. Look where it is now. Mm-hmm. And it's all parties.
You're in favour of Trump. You were in favour of Brexit.
Absolutely.
You're not happy with the Labour Party?
Well, not at all, no. Mm-hmm. Especially how they run. No, not at all, no.
The masses have voted for, you know, Brexit. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because we need change. Yeah.
Politicians, that's all they want. The career, yeah. And money.
Jo Cox's death was a terrible tragedy that was felt widely but changed little. What would she make of the world as it is today?
Jo Cox was killed, brutally murdered, on the street just behind me 5 months ago. But the wounds inflicted by that tragedy are still very open in this town. That's all from here in Birstall. Over to you, John, in London.
Thank you, Matt. Well, I'm joined now by Alison McGovern, a Labour MP and a close friend of Jo Cox. Alison McGovern, and the world and Britain have entered a new political era. Those are the words of Matt up there in Birstall. And that's true, and that world appears to have many of the causes that she really believed in under siege.
Well, in some ways, I think it's too much an old story where economic injustice is blamed on outsiders or those who are a little different from people. And actually, that's not the cause. You know, if politics and economics doesn't serve ordinary working people, then we've got to deal with that. And we can't allow the forces of hatred to blame minority communities. You know, we've got to stand up against this view. Of course, we've got to have an economy that works for everybody. We've got to deal with the real problems that people face, absolutely. But I, for one, won't stand by whilst the kind of hate that killed Jo is allowed to be perpetuated.
That's recognised, and indeed her husband said that whatever's happening in France, whatever's happening in America, is not yet on that scale here. But no, the issue here too is, and you heard it in that bar, the absolute loathing of politics, the feeling that the thing is disintegrated. You heard that man say, it's time for a businessman and the rest of it. There's disenchantment with your place, the Commons, and your activities.
Well, look, when Jo died, actually, we saw a huge outpouring of love and care, and the causes that she championed, whether it is civilian protection in Syria or the problem of loneliness affecting older people and young people, we're going to fight for those causes and take them on. And actually, the person who killed Jo, if his aim was to silence her and what she stood for, he will be utterly unsuccessful because her voice is louder now than it has been before. You know, I speak to my constituents and would happily go and talk to those gentlemen and try and listen to what they've got to say and have a good old-fashioned debate with them about what they think. And that's the way to demonstrate that our politics can work, that all of us became MPs and Jo became a Member of Parliament for a reason. Because our politics, if we do it properly and we listen to people and we talk with them, it can work and you can get things changed. I think it was George Osborne, actually, who, when he paid tribute to Jo, you know, he said that she had changed government policy and she changed a huge amount in just a year, you know, more than some people do in their whole lifetime. So I think her example actually demonstrates that our democracy can work if we want it to.
But both parties are riven. I mean, they have divisions in the Tory party and there are terrible divisions in your party. And you wonder what Jo would have made of it because, I mean, she was a new MP. Would she perhaps even have been alienated by what's going on in Parliament?
Well, I think we have to follow her example, John. You know, I saw Jo reach out to people on all sides of the political debate within and outside our party, the Labour Party. You know, I saw her reach across the division of the House of Commons to work with Andrew Mitchell. You know, as an opposition MP for the previous 5 years, I'd opposed him. She reached out to him and she got much more done that way than I had done. So we will follow in Jo's example and we will make sure that her causes are pursued with the kind of rigour that she would expect of us.
You were close to her and you were close to her politically and socially. Do you miss her still?
Of course, but her smile and her love is still with us.
Alison McGovern, thank you very much indeed for joining us. Cathy.
So, jam tomorrow or even today?